contributed a lot to the veterans community in Nova Scotia and beyond through his work as a psychologist. Over the last few years, he's also started to contribute to academic debate and political debate on veterans issues, and he's been really prolific. We're all jealous of how many books he can write in 3 years, right? He's put out 3 books now since I've known you. So he's a great inspiration in that respect as well. What I've learned the most from John, I think, is the importance of listening and taking seriously these stories of veterans, and the importance of looking for ways to reconnect and build community.
Hey, Maya, and thank you to Sophie and to the university for hosting me tonight. I mean, it's a great place to be. So here's the question. What does it take to transform young men and women into our watchdogs and combatants, guardians capable of lethality? So what I lay out really is to explore the effects of military and paramilitary conditioning and creating special identities among those who work in the front lines. In 2009, David Grossman, an American veteran and psychologist, wrote a book called On Killing. And he argued, and I agree, it takes tremendous effort to teach youngsters to overcome a natural resistance to inflicting pain and death on others. We are exposed to intense, all-encompassing experiences that most people can't imagine. And practically, we must find the mental place to become toughened, a little less human, I think. To place rationality, mental focus, and controlled aggression, and I don't mean violence, above all those as our default modes. And I think they're vitally important to understand when we talk about this notion, well, it's not a notion, it's a reality, of how do people transition to civilian life. And we forget that part. And I think we need to think about it seriously. So what does it take then? Military trainees undergo, and some first response, undergo a rigorous set of experiences meant to transform us from civilians into focused and competent soldiers. And by soldiers, I mean sailors and Air Force men and women as well. To take on clarity of purpose, shared values, and loyalty to one another, above all. And it's a psychological conditioning process, that's my argument, as well as particular skills and abilities, it is really mental conditioning. We are taught that we are better than civilians, and we all know that. We have to stamp out vulnerability and to learn to suppress our emotional lives in the name of duty, which may include lethality. This is the conditioning required of all brothers and sisters in arms. There's a disconnect, though, between this family and the civilian family, because we're taught to, we have to reject civilian norms in order to make room for military norms. Two modes, stand by and action, right? No room for vulnerability, which I believe contributes to burnout, sometimes, oftentimes confused with PTSD, not discounting the problem of traumatic stress, but sometimes it is confused, or just worn out. So becoming special. We have a general belief in Canada that the military represents all Canadians. And if you look closely, that's not entirely accurate. And it's not accurate in the United States either. The majority of military people come from connections to the military and traditional masculine value systems around stoicism, emotional toughness, and self-reliance. The other part that gets lost, and I want to be careful about this, is a lot of people who end up in first response roles and military roles come from childhood challenged families. Many join in search of a new family or a continuation of their military families. So for those folks, and there are a number, the idea then of transitioning back to civilian life is not true, because we're going back for a first time. And it's terrifying for a lot of people. I spent 9 years in the Navy. I learned confidence. I learned a lot of other things that I won't say here. That pushing limits, take control. Go ahead, Gary, you're going to have to leave. And forming lifelong friendships. So coming from a little place in Newfoundland, you know, shy, introverted, By the time I had finished basic training, I'd forgotten that guy. I loved the transformation, right? And most of us do. We're larger than life. We can take on the world. And we're reminded of that all the time, right? I was one of those guys they call the true believer. You're just a gung-ho lifer, man. And it wasn't meant as a compliment, right? Because it really was a whole new world. So the idea then of hanging out of a helicopter over the North Atlantic at 41, or serving on a Norwegian frigate near Russian waters during the Cold War, or tracking nuclear subs off our East Coast, don't tell me I wasn't special. And I don't mean that from an ego sense of adjustment, that's the way it was. Matter of fact, my wife and my family didn't even know what I did, because we weren't about the same. If I went home to Newfoundland, they'd ask me how the Army was. How was the Army? Well, I don't know. They're probably pretty good, but I'm in the goddamn Navy. So, I mean, it is our own world. So, this is what I'm really interested in from a whole series of events. The effects of conditioning on our identity formation, because I really do believe we form a new identity and it never goes away. And its effect on mental health, both during our service and after our service, across all our first response roles, the number one priority is to control and use adrenaline in the face of danger, to use it to stay focused, to take charge, and to never hesitate. It's to run in and not run away. Don't stop by it. So a key requirement to do this is this notion of having to detach, maybe even to personalize stuff, it's not me, and to suppress anything we feel emotionally. And I'll talk a lot about that. That's a mental skill set. And this is not meant to criticize the military or first response, because that skill set to do that job is absolutely required for people to be safe, to be able to do the job. You know, a 23-year-old policeman takes control of a motor vehicle accident, a fatality. A young paramedic is trying to do compressions on a 47-year-old on a sidewalk with onlookers, and they go home. So who do they talk to about with them? Certainly not their family, not with a stranger, and not with their colleagues. Because reputation and being in control is everything. And if you can't maintain it, you can't be trusted. And if you can't be trusted, you have to go. Now, some things are changing on that when we talk about, you know, new initiatives, mental health in the workplace and resilience and things like that. But underneath that, I mean, there's certainly some fears as well. I mean, if you come forward, there's help. And there's help within limitations. And if you can't get it under control or do it, then people risk their livelihoods. And that's also a reality I think we have to sort out once and for all. So most people get into this pattern of having to ramp up, charge up, and try to come down. So we get into all kinds of other issues then of how do you do that? Well, alcohol, prescription drugs, other things, other behaviors, to try to get out of the mode, just try to get it under control for a while until you gotta go do it again. And that's a cycle that a lot of people get caught in. And that's when people like me usually see them. They're right in the middle of that, trying to hang on. Is this serious enough already?
You're banging on it.
It is a serious topic, and I don't want to I don't want to overemphasize that, but I don't want to make light of it either, because it is really a serious topic facing us. So people learn to compartmentalize, to detach, and as I said, you can't manage, you can't be trusted. There's a lot of stigma, self-stigma. If I can't manage it, then I'm a failure of my training, and I'm failing my peers. And that's also the other element. This is Medrick's, and Medrick gave me permission. Does that permission still hold, Medrick?
Yes.
Heroes cast long shadows. And to paraphrase, we award people with medals, especially for bravery and outstanding courage, and what that comes with, and if you want to better phrase it, Medrick, you certainly can, is that when you're left with that, then the expectation is that you could do that any time at the drop of a pin, that you're it. You're the beacon. But there's no room in that for the effect on the person themselves, the second guessing, the what if, the effects, being left with it. There's no room for that because you're on the pedestal. And so that fear, yeah. So when young men and women take on this larger than life roles in institutions with pride and specialness and value systems based on the notions of ruggedness and independence, specialness is incredibly seductive, right? It propels us to be able to do the extraordinary, and it's also attractive. And we need this level of assuredness and maybe even cockiness to do what's expected and demanded of us. The same qualities, again, place us at odds with our families, with our employers, and with everyday people. We're often seen as controlling, perfectionistic, unfeeling, aggressive people looking for special attention. But it's the only way to know how to be, or shut down. So the leftovers of this type of conditioning makes it very difficult to come back home, whatever that means. Back home to community, come back home to the people we were before, kind of taking on that training and these roles. So I believe that we need to acknowledge the costs of pride and special identities and their mismatch with everyday life. Many veterans talk about being equipped with a switch, the on-off switch, that they're left to control on their own. The potential for aggression must be controlled. And it's not necessarily violence. It's the tendency to take action, to go after something. Or the opposite is to shut down. Most people manage that by socially withdrawing because the fear is that it can go off at any time. So the safest thing is for me to be in my basement. If I'm in my basement, you're safe. If I were to really ask, and I do ask sometimes veterans, what are you afraid of? The fear is never of other people. The fear is of what I might do if you push me enough. And that's, again, gets lost under the rubric of PTSD. So as it stands then, those worn out mentally by the job are recreated as former heroes when they leave. And if they're injured on the job, they're recreated as victims. Personal price that people have to pay to receive support. By support, I mean therapies, pensions, and things like that. That's the felt experience for people. For most, you know, all of the people I see, or we see. And it's often experienced as a source of shame, sometimes said, often not said. And let's be honest, we have no room in society for victims as productive citizens. They're often receive sympathy at one end of the spectrum, and at the other, the one we don't like to talk about, is skepticism and judgment on the other end of the spectrum, and there is a spectrum. So our public institutions also are wary of admitting, I think, their responsibilities in fostering environments and personalities incapable of admitting vulnerability, because there's no room. We do need them to be called bulletproof, which creates the notion of institutional pressure cookers. Right now have been reports about, you know, the workplace harassment issues, and in general, public workplaces, sometimes sexualized workplaces, impersonal bureaucratic management practices, combative insurance providers. I mean, again, not all, but they're certainly there. One of the things I want to talk about with traumatic stress, or things that traumatize people, it is not only the horrific events, it is not only the explosion and the awful thing that creates traumatic stress, but we're led to believe that's what it is. And if it's not that thing, then they must be fine. And that's not true in our case at all. You know, in our experience over the past 25 years, there are many other stories. But we get stuck in the idea that it's somehow related to the Great War. So we've had all kinds of images of those in the last few days. If you look at anything on the channels, I mean, everything is kind of churning back to terrible, terrible war situations. And again, as I said at the beginning, that does not necessarily, that does not reflect the reality of modern day veterans. Anything from Korea onward, that's not the reality. So the contradiction, to do their jobs, first responders must accept specialists being larger than life, invincible, and an office of promise of never having to face, you know, things that are human, which is, of course, set up for traumatic reactions in the long term because we can't find a way to be able to address them. So to function in everyday life, though, we must develop other qualities, like humility and vulnerability, and compassion, and genuine interconnectedness, if we're going to get along with other human beings. The uncomfortable reality is lost in our national cliche in terms of our heroes. And the reality, of course, is that it's not a nice reality, but the reality is that nobody's 10 foot tall, and in time we will all be forgotten. That's just life. So I think it's important also to put this in a context. I mean, since the mid-1990s, I'm old enough, and some other people in the room are old enough as well, in the mid-90s, we went to downsizing and rationalizing and all that. That's had implications, and I think it's some of the research now that we look at that is coming home to roost in terms of burnout in the workplace, in terms of some of the effects on people across our public institutions. They're not psychologically safe places in that they can't be accommodated in the workplace, accommodated for a while, and you're gone. You can't really say what's going on without somebody running and wanting to put a label because they're unsafe. I can't, you know, we can't have a conversation about being human without raising liability concerns. And that's what our workplace has seemed to turn into, unfortunately. And there's some push and some acknowledgement that we need to kind of bring that back in. But I think we've been left with that legacy as well. And it also contributes to institutions like the RCMP and the military and other first response places. So context is important. So again, in terms of the people we don't see the people who move on their lives and benefit from the military service or the first response service, go on to be great leaders in the community. We don't see those people. So to be sure, I mean, I have to say, not everybody is affected negatively. The people we see, of course, and the people who are in the news and the people who are having problems are the people that are my kind of topic, right? There's some people who are more vulnerable to the conditioning of military conditioning, I argue, and invested in the search for specialness. People who have the hardest time post-service are seem to be the true believers in the roles they took on. And many of them, apart from what you might hear in the media or elsewhere, these were the star performers, the 110%ers, the go-getters. Those are the people we see for the most part. The ones for whom the military and the first response world was their only family, the only real family they'd ever known, so they gave everything to it. The question, though, is who provides them the possibility of redemption or repair when they carry things that they don't know what to do with? Right, for participating in situations that involve death or destruction or bearing witness to atrocities that they were helpless to prevent or intervene. Many people, some people I know, the alternative is to seek out other ways of continuing to look for things to be proud of now, to kind of overcome that. And that becomes another thing that can wear people out if they're not careful with that. So, as I said, most people are star performers. Most of them come from, many of them come from extremely stressful backgrounds in search of, as I said, purpose and self-worth, which makes them exquisitely suited to military and first response roles. Other people grow up in military or policing families, and again, tough, self-reliant, resilient kids, they make great soldiers and first responders. But most forms of help in my world and other programs only focus on the military or the operational events. So in many cases, things that happen before the military is either not our responsibility, but happen on our watch, we don't want to know about it. Or if it's disclosed, it's used by insurers and bureaucrats to disqualify legitimate claims. And that's the rub, right? Part of the spoiled goods argument.
Can you say that again before the rub?
Okay. So when, say, a soldier or an RCMP officer comes forward and says, you know, this thing happened, it's operational, an assessment's done, a history is taken, and they talk about, you know, matter of fact, they've grown up in a family where dad was, you know, was a bit out of control, he drank a lot, and so he never felt safe growing up. So often what that information will do when it goes to an organization, it could be Veterans Affairs, it could be an insurance company, they'll go, aha, we'll see, that's not really related to the service. That's because this happened when you were 8. So we don't think you have a legitimate claim. And we've been involved in many of them here where we've had to argue, fight, and just say, okay, here's the science. You may make that decision, but it's not based on any science. And in a number of cases, you know, they've been overturned, not easily, but they've been overturned. So that's the kind of thing that happens quietly, and I know a lot of veterans who really have to struggle with that, and sometimes it takes years.
That's just the ones we hear about that come to you.
Yeah. So the question then is, on this front, I think it's an important question, does a family history then negate the effects of military service or operational service? My contention, as you know by now, is, and you may disagree, is that once a person undergoes military conditioning and agrees to put their lives on the line, that which changes us fundamentally, as I said, I don't think we can ever disentangle the influences of pre-service life. Whatever happened before, it gets lost, complicated, interwoven what happens in terms of training and then deployment. So you can't say, we'll just pick that out, thank you very much. So again, so the irony is that the very histories that make people great soldiers and first responders can be used to disqualify them. And that is probably the biggest frustration that we face, is trying to argue and to lay it out in people's appropriate coverage and compensation, things like that. And we can't, so there's some press these days about moral injuries, you know. And the definition I use is that any assault on one's service values or pre-service values constitutes a moral injury. And almost every case of PTSD we've seen over the years, and we've seen many, many cases, it involves some moral dilemma, which you could say is at the base of a moral injury. You know, I became a monster to be able to do the job. We didn't help them. Or my family, if my parents knew, my family knew, they'd be ashamed of me. They'd be ashamed of us. And people are left to carry that. So I think we have to, a responsibility then to unravel all of their experience if we're to return to, help them return to community. And that involves people outside the military and first response world. Because it's families, it's small communities. And the problems, I come from Newfoundland, you end up going back to a little place nowhere. How do you connect back into that world and not live in the basement? And I don't think we can continue to ignore the ghosts in our community and those who die prematurely without getting into the arguments over statistics and all that, because depending on who's reporting the number, you can never keep track of them from day to day. So my argument is that there's a cost to living an emotionally stoic life. And if we accept that neurobiological changes, because there's lots of research around brains and PTSD, but if we accept, as quote, the science would tell us, that changes in our brain are really adaptations to our external environment. We live in a world. We respond in that world. And our brain responds accordingly. So if we accept that, repercussions or the consequences of service is not some underlying pathology, but a response to environment, then the idea of stigmatizing people as brain injury becomes a conversation we need to have. We need to look at the cost of emotional suppression in particular, and I'll just look at Ledoux on the left. He's the person that first came up with the idea, and people have heard this, to be honest, heard PTSD story at all, the amygdala gone offline. He was the originator. Of course, it was co-opted and taken away from him. He said, whoa, hold on here, I didn't say that at all. It's not a structural part of our brain that goes wacky. We adapt to an environment, and our brain learns to be in that mode. And it can unlearn to be in that mode. So we have to overcome the idea, I think, that emotional sensitivity, vulnerability, and our personal human reactions to pain and suffering is somehow its weakness. It's a persistent and unfortunate belief in our systems, and we know why, because we leave people tough and locked down. But it's also a belief I think we hold generally in the public, right? We're stoic Canadians, we have a British legacy, you don't talk about stuff. We're starting to, right? But, you know, we kind of hold on to things. We have to be strong, you know, and kind of suck it up a bit, right? I mean, within reason, I mean, I understand it within reason, but we go so far that it's not okay to have conversations. So here's the other part. From soldier to citizen, I think veterans and the country at large is struggling with this question. I'll just read a comment from a young man from Afghanistan, veteran. Man, we're rock stars over there. Politicians, actors, sports stars coming up to shake our hands. What are you supposed to do for an encore after that? Now I'm just a scared nobody. I'm going to read another part briefly from the book. Find the book. So again, another Afghanistan veteran, probably late 30s. You know, I've been out for nearly 2 years. Marriage is on the rocks. My brother and sister won't talk to me anymore. Can't sleep. Pissed off all the time. But I just smile at everybody on the outside. God damn it, I was the chief. I was the center. It was me that got things done. I loved the intensity and always having multiple things going on all at once. It used to piss me off when we had to go to the bunker for hours because of stupid rocket attacks over there. I even asked to have a desk set up down there so I can even work instead of wasting time. I don't want to be out. I hate it out here. And if my body hadn't let me down physically, I'd still be there. Our veterans are usually placed in typically one of three categories. They're heroes, villains, and that's more in the U.S. than here in Canada, or as victims, and labels that obscure the realities of their lives. So as a society, we have not entertained a profound question, I think. One is, can we bring soldiers back home mentally? And if so, how do we go about doing that? You know, my Uncle George that I mentioned earlier, he never came back mentally. Matter of fact, he died alone in a rooming house in his early 60s. I was about a year in the military. And he's not alone, as we know, because it couldn't be talked about. The reality is that even the soldiers never deploy overseas for better or worse, whenever the people who were before joining. The mental conditioning, the values, and the codes are simply too ingrained. So some things I think about is, what could we do? I think to begin to consider and scrutinize the conditioning strategies used to make, quote, real men and women out of our sons and daughters, and what is needed to undo some of this conditioning. Give veterans a voice to tell their own stories in their own words. Not have me tell the stories on their behalf. I think it would be more reality for them to be able to tell their own stories. Support meaningful homecoming rituals. We don't have any parades or public acknowledgments for those who leave the military. Matter of fact, we join together, we train together, we deploy together, and most often, sometimes people come home alone if they're physically injured. encourage our politicians and policymakers to create, and the term, the word I use is psychologically safe workplaces. And by that I mean being able to have, one of the things I talked with the base commander about a year ago, of having, you know, you have off this, off that, have an off green zone, where you can go and talk and not have repercussions, but places where people can feel safe to lower their guard for even just a while. That was a great idea, and then it was posted. Decide once and for all whether we owe, what we owe, or whether we owe a social debt. I know Aaron's and folks at West struggles in that regard as well. The social debt that is owed to those who serve, and to stop politicizing their struggles and their issues. I think we need to challenge the practice of medicalizing and sanitizing veterans' concerns, because it's the only narrative that exists if you have a problem. Otherwise, you should be fine. Create spaces, and by spaces I mean, and Ryan and I've talked a lot about this social space, that challenge and invite the veteran community to engage the civilian community as part of this notion of being able to come home, right? I mean, come home emotionally, to come home mentally, not just physically. So our hero-victim narrative, while self-congratulatory, I think, for the rest of us, does not do service to veterans in the long run. It tends to trap them in diminishment and loss of pride and purpose. I think it's all of our job. The real work has been left to wives and children, parents, other veterans, grassroots efforts that exist largely in public view. We don't see this, we don't hear about this generally. I think in the end, we continue to reduce veteran concerns, including loss of identity and mental illness, managing private offices. Again, we missed the point. We need to help people to reprogram or deprogram or whatever the term is without making it sound too mechanistic, to reestablish meaningful connections and relationships after the service. And transition is much, much more than getting a job. As most veterans know in this room, there's no problem getting a job. It's keeping a job and putting up with people who don't have the same standards and values or view of the world. It's tough to show up day two, right? Military and first responder identity ends up being a core identity. It's central to people. And I think that gets missed as well. And it's based on rejection of civilian norms, adoption of the skill set that I talked about, the mental skill set, taking on special purpose and unique ways of seeing the world, and the fact of it is incredibly valuable because it works to keep people safe. The problem is it does not fit for the most part in the civilian world. And the problem is I have this, I know this, it doesn't work. What am I supposed to do? And the answer for a lot of people, of course, is the basic or withdrawing, or shrinking down the world because I don't know how to manage that. So about 10,000 people released every year from their Canadian forces. About 16% are identified for physical and mental health problems, leading to medical release. That's a statistic we have, the official statistic. But of course, many people come forward years later, sometimes decades later, and they're not included in that statistic either. Veterans have earned the right to be proud of their service. But how do they reconcile the loss of their visible signs of specialness? Uniforms, special badges, ID cards, medals, replaced often by anonymity among the rest of us. So that's the struggle for a lot of folks. It's a vexing question and that we don't answer. I'll leave you with these questions. And I think I'll read this as well. I think if we dare risk looking closely at military or first response, then the veterans in our lives, and we listen carefully and look carefully, we may see that the war doesn't stay over there. It really does come home with them. I think we have an obligation to provide them the means of finding hope and maybe even rediscovering some of the things they had before they took on service. And people are able to do that. So after reading the book, I really do hope that you'll think about these questions. You know, how do we as a society recognize the cost of taking on special identities that most people may not be able to identify with? How do care providers, this is my world, incorporate these fundamental losses into ways of helping that don't stigmatize and pathologize people and trap them in permanent patient roles? And of course, the last is, are there better ways beyond pathology for veterans and for all the rest of us to understand their basic struggles? You know, special identities that most people may not be able to identify with. How do care providers, this is my world, incorporate these fundamental losses into ways of helping that don't stigmatize and pathologize people and trap them in permanent patient roles? And of course, the last is, are there better ways beyond pathology for veterans and